All right, so I got like 30 forwards of this article. It hit the news. It was published in the first week of April, and it's now come into the mainstream news, and that's why all of you all are forwarding this to me. All of you all are worried about the safety of protein supplements. So let's go through this article together, and I'll tell you what I think about it and what you should do. So protein powders, of course, India loves being scared of protein powders. And sure, there is some merit to this study. It helps us to understand what we should be looking for as consumers. But the amount of hype and phobia management or phobia mongering that goes on for protein powders in India, we don't have nearly as much fear of carbohydrate powders, which are definitely making us sick. If there's one thing that we're getting sick of in India, it is carbohydrate powders in our daily food supply. But sure, let's analyze this paper about protein powders. So it's a self-funded study looking at protein supplements in India to look for hepatotoxic, that means things that are toxic to the liver based on industrial standards. They look for fungal poisons, pesticide, heavy metals, and other additive chemicals, which you really don't want to be eating. Most protein supplements did not meet the required content that they advertised, that they said they're getting you X number of grams of protein that was not found to be in the package. And some of them had concerns about protein amino spiking. I have no idea what this means, so I'd be happy to learn more about this. Fungal toxins and pesticide residues. This is important. Okay, and we'll come to what this means in a couple of sentences. Heavy metals and herbal extracts. Indian-made products were inferior to those manufactured by multinational companies. Presence of toxic compounds. Non-standardized, unregulated. Manufacturers must consider reducing ingredient complexity to prevent interactions. They must avoid using toxic ingredients. Yes. And here's some like background, and they're telling you the FSSAI does not approve of HDS, which is herbal and dietary supplements. So it says they do not do the approving of them, but they regulate good manufacturing practices. So basically, what this means is these supplements are not monitored by any particular agency. Just like the FDA. The FDA in the US does not monitor the safety or the validity of these supplements. Same way FSSAI does not approve or disapprove of herbal and dietary supplements. FSSAI comments on manufacturing practices. So, the safety of contents in protein-based herbal and dietary supplements must be ensured by the manufacturer, the person who's trying to sell this to you. While the content and the labeling are analyzed by FSSAI based on test results submitted by the manufacturer, these are not made public and remain non-transparent. So a lot of the questions that patients are asking me as a doctor, we don't have access to that information. The way we have access to information about safety of medications, which go through trials, and you have to study groups for years at a time. Equal groups on both sides, one group gets the medicine, one group doesn't get the medicine, and you observe for changes. None of that safety protocol is used when you're analyzing these kind of supplements. Of course, this question still comes to the doctor, so here we are trying to analyze this information. And protein supplements do remain mislabeled, deceptive, misleading, and unclear. And so many of you have come to us, and we work with you on label reading, and we do help you within that sea of confusion to try with whatever is publicly available to make decisions. All right, and to try and avoid unnecessary additives or ingredients. We do that with you all the time. Now, on the large body of evidence, view the full article. The large body of evidence on this related liver toxicity lacks qualitative product analysis. We aim to analyze through good methodology, etc., with transparency. We did an exhaustive protein quantitative product qualitative chemical and toxicology analysis based on industrial standards on popular Indian brands. Great. So they did their product purchase and preparation. They made a list. They verified authenticity. And then the expiry information, they looked at the labels, each product was numbering, and identifying information was removed from the product covering. So there was a blinded study. So the people analyzing the powders didn't know which brand powder they were looking at. Great, that's a pretty good way of looking into things. The study people should not know what's happening. They should be just assessing the question that's being asked of them. There was a chain of command. Once it was received, they were opened under standard operating conditions. Powders were transferred to sterile containers and then closed and stored. Okay, great. Then comes protocols. They did their methodologies of how they tested these powders. Again, great that somebody from the public is trying to do this. This is something most you and me, people like you and me, just don't have access to doing these things. We don't have access to such labs and such investigative tools. We're just you consumers just like you at the end of the day. Results, ta-da! 36 supplements were analyzed. Seals were maintained, blinded with the packaging and seals removed, open for analysis under standard conditions. And they were then unblinded for the product. The unblinding was just to match the product to the output. That was just at the end stage. And there was, in absence of the funder, collated the summary. So they're trying to tell us that there was no financial incentive to these results. The following protein powders were checked: blended, pure plant-based, pure whey-based. There were different blends of proteins or herbal extracts. Of the 14 blends, 7 of them had herbal extracts. The rest of them had various types of protein. 4 products were purely plant-based, 18 were purely whey-based, and whey blends. Now, whey blends is concentrate, hydrolysate, and isolate. 20 of the 36 were made in India, 16 were multinational. Of the 36 products, 9 of them had less than 40% detected protein content, while the rest had above 60%. A lot of these labels mention that they are 80% protein. So 25% were mislabeled about the content. That is, content per 100 gram was less than advertised, featuring from anywhere less than 10% mistake to 50%. So you might be thinking you're taking 25 grams of protein in the scoop, but you're actually getting 12. That's not something we're happy about. 2 products from one particular manufacturer had 62 to 50% lower. So this seems to be a pretty notorious source, which is very underrepresented in terms of they're overrepresenting what they're giving you in the box. And a commonly prescribed protein from a well-reputed company also mislabeled it approximately 30% deficit, right? So if they're telling you you're getting 100, you're actually getting 70. Now you know, those who work with us, why I keep on giving you a protein score. We don't just give you full marks for things you buy in health food stores, very excited that you got this protein chips and the amount of processing and stuff that happens. Now you know why we're always cutting protein scores. Protein brands were found to contain more than the label. So certain ones had more than the labeled. Higher protein content could suggest good quality sources, manufacturing, or part of protein amino spiking, where they intentionally add cheaper components such as amino acids glycine and taurine to deceptively showcase higher protein content. Looks like we still need more research on this. They don't seem to have a clear answer. On the fungal analysis, samples were contaminated. 5 out of 36, that's 14% samples were contaminated. Now here I want to object to you guys for all the panic that y'all are going through. If you are going to be worried about the fungal content and pesticide content of protein supplements, I want you to know that most of those problems were found in the plant-based supplements. Guess what? The plant-based protein is coming from a plant. Where do you think the fungus and the pesticide is coming from? Only sits on the protein, or it sits on the plant? And therefore, because it's on the plant, it's getting into the protein supplement. What does that mean? That means if you are eating grains that are commercially grown, whether you take brown rice or quinoa or peas as whole grains, or you turn them into carbohydrate powders and you eat them as healthy carbohydrate snacks, brown rice cookies or quinoa puffs, you don't think that these fungal poisons and aflatoxin and pesticide poisons are getting into your carbohydrate powders? Who's done the study to show you that the fungus and the pesticide on the whole plant has not entered into your carbohydrate supply? You're just looking at evidence that plant-based protein supplements have these residues in the protein that's being analyzed. And there's a cognitive bias and a mental heuristic going on over here where people become illogical. They think that what you see is all there is. So if I tell you there's residue in plant-based protein supplements, you seem to forget that that means that there is also going to be this residue on the plant itself and in other foods that I'm already eating. Even if I decide to be deathly scared of protein supplements from today onwards, are you done? You're still probably consuming those same pesticides and fungal elements in the plant-based foods that you eat. So be rational when you're looking at this kind of information. Trace things back to their root. So on the fungal analysis, 5 out of 36 samples had aflatoxins, which are fungal toxins. Pesticides, 8% had trace residue. Heavy metals, none of the protein contained mercury or thallium. There was a uniform standard of copper. Interestingly, the lowest protein content was amongst protein brands that were promoted, heavily promoted and commonly prescribed. So advertising does not mean it's better. Aflatoxins have been found in plant-based. I already told you what that means. Pesticides were only in plant-based because you don't go spraying pesticides on cows, do you? You spray pesticides on plants. So again, I'm telling you, if it's in the plant-based protein, it's in the plant-based grain and plant-based carbohydrate also. You're just not looking at that study right now. Pesticides were not found in dairy-based or blended dairy supplements. And they've shown you table 1. And this is some data if you like numbers. And they're giving you some brands with hepatotoxic herbs, means liver toxic herbs, some herbal additives. Again, we as allopathic doctors don't know about these herbs at all. Okay, and then they're talking to you about certain brands. Compared to multinational brands, Indian brands were of lower quality, higher chance of contamination, poor manufacturing practices, risk of including multiple liver toxic ingredients, mostly herbal blends. Now, you guys got to be careful because all these ads are coming to you saying take this herb and that herb, and we don't know really the safety profile of all of those. 16 brands out of 25 that had mislabeled protein content were made by Indian-based manufacturers. All right, so be aware of this when you're shopping in the market. And if you want to get your protein from whole plant-based or whole animal-based, always go for that first. Nobody's forcing you to take a protein supplement. We talk to our patients about getting your protein intake to target through natural whole foods first. But if you're going to panic looking at this article, please be thoughtful about the fact that those chemicals are probably in your plant-based food supply already anyways. And they're looking at other toxins. None of the products had steroids or hormones, even though plant-based had identifiable phytosteroids. Heterogeneity, identified components, discussion. All right. So the self-funded report on popular proteins revealed interesting, intriguing, and concerning findings. Most of the supplements did not have as much as they advertised. Certain brands had more, might be spiking with cheaper proteins or cheaper amino acids. Fungal and pesticide residues were in identifiable good brands, particularly in the plant-based ones. And we know that that means these things are growing on or sprayed onto the plants. So it's in your food anyway. Presence of broad types of potentially compounds, etc. Researchers in Spain checked on the protein declared on the supplement using a methodology like that in our paper. They observed differences between declared and real proteins and concluded that the quality and safety of these products needs to be monitored and regulated with a high because there's a high degree of non-compliance with claims, and this echoed our findings. I agree. So all of you who are wondering, should I panic now? What should I do? Where do I eat safe things? That's a great question. We need our authorities and our officials who are in charge of not just helping small businesses grow and start sending us protein supplements on the market for our predominantly vegetarian population, not only to help commerce to happen, capitalism to happen, but to ensure safety and quality standards. That is a very uncharted territory, and we're all facing that right now. So like I said, you get to pick how you're getting protein to target. You're probably consuming things with pesticides and fungal toxins in your plant-based food supply anyway. A recent study highlighted that they were frequently mislabeled aflatoxins four products, all plant-based, three were soy-based, one was a multi-herbal. In two of them, aflatoxin was very high. Consumers must be aware of protein sources, especially plant-based, linked to natural contamination with fungal mycotoxins that can negatively impact health. Well, that's happening even if you eat plant-based foods, because the protein is not the only one getting those fungus in nature, right? You're understanding? I'm saying this five times because y'all are getting distracted by the media sending you highlights, headlines, making you scared of the protein. I want you to trace this back to where those things got on those plants. Okay. And then there was a contaminated, above safe limits, not allowed, fully processed protein products respectively, higher than safe limits in food products, multiple adverse outcomes. Correct. We don't want to be eating chemicals. We don't want to be eating pesticides. That's not a problem that is going to be solved just by eliminating protein supplements. You have a lot of work cut out for you if you're trying to eliminate chemicals from your food supply. So I'm not sure that I have the perfect answer for you, what you should be eating, because we're all sitting in this world disconnected from ancient hunter-gatherer lives or ancient, you know, growing things in my backyard and eating it straight without any chemical interference. That the days of natural organic farming are quite gone. We all eat commercially grown food. So this will happen. Herb-blended proteins containing hepatotoxic herbs were a concern, especially Indian manufacturers. Green tea extract with risks. Turmeric-based. Look at that. Everybody wants to ask me about curcumin and turmeric. Turmeric-based dietary supplements are an increasingly concerning cause of severe liver injury and liver failure, so much so that Italian health prohibited all claims linked to turmeric and warnings for turmeric-containing health supplements. Some people are selling some pretty expensive turmeric and curcumin out there. Garcinia and Malabar, consistently associated with liver injury. Products containing Malabar extracts are banned in the US. And ashwagandha, studies from USA and Europe and now India, can be associated with cholestatic hepatitis, which can be self-limiting but can be fatal in pre-existing liver disease. So, and again, this article is published by, I think, a department that has a great interest in liver health, and that's great. I'm all for liver health. We're all for, you know, reversing things like fatty liver, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. So I will tag the people who publish this on my post so that they can comment, and I would be happy to have a further good discussion about this. Okay. Let's learn and increase each other's knowledge. No, there's no point freaking out and panicking when we see headlines. So impact of this on health. Nonetheless, our study was transparent results aimed at educating the public at large. Comes at the right time when the government of India has proclaimed 40,000 cases, various nutraceutical companies that manufacture and sell supplements that were unsafe and did not meet standards. Good. I am happy to know that the government of India is pulling up manufacturers to be accountable to what they make people buy and eat. And we don't want to be misleaded. We are the public. We want to be getting the right information for our own health. They talk about their limitations and how they could do a better job. Sure, research can always be improved, and this is a starting journey. I credit the publishers of this paper for taking the initiative. I just want to say that since we're doing this on protein supplements, we should also do this on our beloved attas and flours. Ragi flour, wheat flour, brown rice flour, quinoa flour, oat flour. Let's do the same pesticide and fungal residue analysis on those daily staples as well, because the public is protein deficient, protein malnourished. We're scaring them away from protein. They need to also know what's going on when they're eating those beloved grains of theirs. All right. So again, great credit to the authors of this paper for taking initiative to do this, self-funded. That's not easy. And, be informed. I don't have any brand affiliations for any of this. So, you know, we are all buying things from the market for our own health, and we just tell you what we buy as consumers, and hopefully we can help each other to, you know, stay healthy and stay out of trouble. All right. So thank you for sharing this with me. A lot of you patients have sent this to me privately in lots of panic, and I figured it deserves a full detailed reply. Take care. Cheers.